some chapter and problems on risk and return. Okay, so they're kind of, I would say they're you know, some basic problems on risk and return that you should be more or less familiar with. Okay, so I've given you the handout. If you look at the outline, and the outline has the risk formula, all right, and then it has the problem, the chapter end problems, as you can see, and then it has the chapter end problems solved in Excel, and then it has the chapter end problems again done manually. Okay, manually. So we'll try to go over as many problems as we want to, as we can actually. So let's open up chapter 6, chapter 9 from our book and see how the questions look like. So the first thing I want you to do is to open the page number 2, which has the risk and return formula, remember that. And then we're going to do one problem at a time. So the first one we have is the expected return. All right, then for the risk, I want you to look at the solutions manual. So just look at the expected return. So it says, well, given the probability distribution, all right, Universal Corporation is planning to invest in a security that has several possible rates of return. Following probability, all right, let's do the expected rate of return. Okay? So again, the formula for the risk is already given in the solutions manual, but we are just going to focus for the time being on the expected return. So let's look at that. So we have the probabilities, and then we have the return distribution. So the first thing I want to ask you is that which formula should we use from the list of formulas that we have? Do we use formula number 1, which is the holding period formula? Do we use formula number 2, 3, 4, and 5? Okay, so I heard somebody saying formula number 2. Let's look at the formulas. All right, so formula number 2 is the P1, R1, P2, R2, PN, RN formula, right? So I agree, and is it clear? Why do you think we are using this formula? Let's look at the problem again. That's correct. Why are we using this formula? Okay? It has the probability and it has the returns, right? So it has the probability distribution. It also has the returns. And so we know automatically that, well, we are going to use P1, R1, P2, R2, P3, R3, and P4, R4. So how do you find the risk? Okay, so the question says again expected return and risk. So let's try to figure out how to calculate the risk. And the formula was again Ri minus R bar 4 square times P of R. Okay? So R bar was 13%. Okay? So we are going to take each of the R's. Okay, so you have minus 1 minus 13 whole square times the probability. Then you're going to do 1 minus 13 whole square, and then times P of R, and then finally you're going to do, I mean, again, you're going to do for each of them, 3 minus 13 whole square times the probability, and 10 minus 13 whole square times the probability, sum them together. Then you have the variance, the variance is 126%, and then you have the sigma, which is nothing but the square root of the variance, okay? So that's how you're going to figure out what the standard deviation is. So it says, given the holding period returns shown here, calculate the average returns and the standard deviations for Kaifu and for the market. So what do we do for this one? How do we calculate this one? So remember here, there are no probabilities in this one, right? No probability. So what do we do for this one? So you have two return series, and they're telling you calculate the standard deviation and calculate the mean. And if you are using Excel, which my online students are going to use, we are just going to do, okay, so we have two series. What is our X bar? Or what is the mean of K Corporation? It is equal average these numbers. And what is the, again, what is the mean for the market? It's equal average that. And then the standard deviations are going to be equal STDEV, and again equal STDEV. But let's go to our next problem. I think it's question number 9. So it says holding period returns, okay? For the price data that follow, compute the holding period returns for periods 2 through 4, okay? So remember again, when you look at this problem and you compare it with that problem, Let's see the problem that we just did, okay? We just did this one, Kaiku and Market. So look at this, these are in percentages, okay? These are in percentages, but these are not in percentages, these are dollar values, okay? So it says calculate the holding period returns from year four, year two to year three, okay? So let's look at our formula sheet again. All right, so we have our formula sheet. We have the holding period return formula is this. Selling price minus cost price plus dividend, if applicable, if there is a dividend, divided by cost price. Okay. Now we go back to our sample. Okay. So we have period 1, 2, 3, 4, and it's asking us to calculate the holding period returns. Okay. So it's not asking us to calculate the standard deviation or the mean or anything, but it's just telling us what is the holding period return from period 2 to period 4. Okay. What is the holding period return? Okay. So for the first one, we are going to do, okay, period, remember selling price in period 2. This is how we did it in your project. Selling price minus cost price divided by cost price, okay. Selling price was 13, cost price was 10 divided by cost price. For period 2 to 3, we have a negative return, $11 minus $13 divided by 13. And for the last one, we have 15 minus 11 divided by 11, okay. So this is called holding period return. So when it says calculate the holding period return for each of these, for months or periods 2 to 4, you have to do it one at a time. And although they didn't ask it, I also calculated the return, average return. Okay? The average return was that minus that plus that divided by 3. So, all right. Let's look at number 11 and try to figure out, well, how do we calculate it? Again, holding period returns are given to us. We don't have to calculate them. It says find the average return for Zemin and the market. So what do we do? So this is going to be X bar. Okay. So only if you are doing it using your financial calculator, okay, you have to remember X bar, Y bar, SX, XY. If you are doing it in Excel, like my online students are going to do, they don't have to care about X bar, Y bar. They just do equal average. This is correlation. This is equal STDEV. Equal STDEV, and if I ask them about correlation, equal correl, but I don't really. Number 15, okay? Question number 15 says, using the capital asset pricing model, estimate the appropriate required rate of return of the three stocks listed here, given the risk-free rate is 5% and the expected return on the market is 12%, okay? So first of all, which formula do we use and why? Go back to our formula again. Which formula do we use, guys and girls? Okay, somebody said 6. I agree. Or I already said capital asset pricing model. Okay, so 6. So again, how do we interpret 6? It says R of I, return on security I equals the risk-free rate plus it should be beta I, beta of the security, times the return on the market minus the risk-free rate. Okay. So R of I equals the risk-free rate plus beta I, RM minus RF. Okay. Now let's go back to the question and let's think about how do we solve this problem. What is it asking us for? Right, so it says, again using CAPM estimates, the appropriate required return, three stocks listed here. Okay. Risk-free rate is 5%, expected return is 12%. Okay, fine. So we have to find three things. Let's find three of them. We have to find R of A, R of B, and R of C. Okay. So this is A, R of A, risk-free rate, beta of A times RM minus RM. Yes or no? All right, so what is R of A?
0.75.
Okay, let's go over that. What is the risk-free rate, guys?
5.
Okay. What is the beta? Times RM minus RF, okay, RM is 12% minus, okay. So this is how we calculate it for R, for A, stock A, okay. So this using a similar logic, we can do R of B and R of C, okay. So remember, for R of B, everything is the same except the beta changes. And for R of C also, everything is the same, meaning the risk-free rate is 5%, market risk premium is 12 minus 5, 7%, and the only thing that changes is, again, the beta of I, okay? So beta B is 0.9, beta C is 1.4. So why don't you guys, 7.3? How about R of C? I have 14.8. The questions like this are not. Look at number 17 now, okay? We are only going to do 17A. It says, determine the expected return and beta for the following portfolio. Okay, I want you to stare at this for a little while and then tell me. Well, it says, determine the expected return and beta for the following portfolio. Let's go back to our formula sheet again and try to figure out which formula or formulas should be used.
Yeah, risk free.
So look at the question again. The questions are in your hands. Determine the expected return and the beta for the portfolio. Okay, somebody said 5. I agree, 5. We use 5. One of the equations we use is 5, this portfolio beta. And we also use 4, which is portfolio return. We have to find two things, portfolio return and portfolio beta. So if you look at this, what is this? What is this percentage of portfolio? What does it mean?
The weight.
We just said it's the weight. Does it make sense to everybody that this is the weight? Percentage allocation to each stock. It's just written percentage of portfolio, but these are the weights, right? So all right. So how do we find RP first of all? How do we find the rate of return on the portfolio? What do we do? So we use this formula, right? We use W1R1, W2R2, WN, RN. And so what? So we multiply for the rate of return on the portfolio, what do we multiply what with?
The weight.
Weight and the return, right? Weight 1, return 1. Weight 2, return 2. Weight 3, return 3. Multiply them across. And that's going to give us the RP. What about the beta P? Alright, so all we have to do is weight times beta 1, weight 2 times beta 2, weight 2 weight 3 times beta 3, and add them together. Okay, so let's go to the solution. If I have it, okay. So for RP, alright, so we have for RP, we multiply again. Let's color this in a different color. RP. Alright, for the first one, we are going to do 0.4 times 12, 0.25 times 11, 0.35 times 15. Okay, so this is RP. And for the beta P, all we do is beta 1 times weight 1, weight 2 times beta 2, weight 3 times beta 3. Okay, so just to put the weights column is kind of, you know, the weights is the weights column. We just multiply it either with the betas or we multiply it with the expected rate of return and we get our RP and the beta P. Okay. So the RP we are going to do weight times return of expected return of stock 1, weight times expected return of stock 2, weight 3 times expected return of stock 3, and for the beta P we are going to do weight 1 times beta 1, weight 2 times beta 2, weight 3 times beta 3. The only thing again, if you look at the formula, the W's are the same. You know, in one case RP we are using the R's, and in the second case for the betas we are using the betas. W1R1, W2R2, W3R3, or W1 beta 1, W2 beta 2, W3 beta 3. So I think 21, just tell me, can we do it? And let's try to solve for number 21. What formula do we use again, guys and girls?
6.
Okay, yes, 6. Very good. What is given to us? Okay, what are we solving for? We're solving again R of I, right? So the beta is given to you 0.86, market return is 11.5, risk free rate is 3. Let's go back. Do we have question number 21? I think I do. Alright, and the answer I get is 10.31%. Can you make sure we all get 10.31? Alright. I'm gonna look at 23 now and I'm gonna ask you which formula do we use for 23 and how do we solve it? So I want you to again, let's look at A and B. It says calculate expected return on the portfolio, calculate beta of the portfolio. So what formulas do I use for number 23? And how do we go about calculating again expected return on the portfolio and expected return and portfolio beta?
Start by multiplying the percentage of the portfolio by the return. And then you
That's
add.
For RP. RP, okay, go ahead, Brad.
And you add those up.
Okay, so we do again, as Brian just said, for calculating RP, 20 times 12%, 30 times 8%, 15 times 12%, 25, and then add them all together. What about from beta P? For what about for beta P, Ashley? How would we calculate the beta P? Weight beta, and then add them all together, right? Simple enough, okay? Conclusions. So let's look at a problem that is part of another handout, but you know, it just says it has these numbers and it says calculate the rate of return on, or calculate the weight for each of them, I think, or calculate the weight for a single one. Calculate, so the question is calculate the weight for A, B, C, and D, let's say. So how do we find the weights for A, B, C, and D? Can you just tell me before I show you the solutions? How do we find the weights for A, B, C, and D? All right, Daniel said we just multiply what with what? Okay, so we do multiply number of shares times price of shares, and then what do we do?
Number of shares times the total price.
And then find the portfolio allocation, right? All right, so we have, this is given to us, all this is given to us. And we do price times shares and then find the weights, right? So price times shares, calculate the market value of the portfolio and then find the weights, okay? So we have for the first one, we have 5,400, 43,200, 3,100, 33,000, and then find the weights, okay? Yes or no? All right, the last one we're going to do for the day is this one. And the question is solve for expected return on the portfolio. Okay, so solve for the expected return on the portfolio, which is also known as RP. So now what do we do? How do we solve for that formula? This is it. So we do have the returns. The returns are given to us. Expected returns are there. We don't have the weights. So based on these two, we have to find the weights, okay? Okay, so that's what we did. We find the weights. Find the weights. Price times share, find the weights. And then once you find the weights, you multiply the weights times the E of R, weight 2, E of R 2. All right, rate of return of A, weight of B, rate of return of B, weight of C, and then add them all together. Yes.
Will we...